itself is made available on the US Department of State website. Even though the convention came into force in it was signed by 31 countries in 1999, the United States joined up in 2003. So in the United States, the convention came into force on November 2003. So, and of course, the convention is applicable to those countries that participate in the convention itself. So in our case, the participating countries would be 137 of them, including People's Republic of China, right there. So yes, originally it was 31 countries. Now we have 137 countries, and which is pretty much the major trading world. So most of the time, the convention will apply as opposed to not apply. Historically speaking, the Montreal Convention took the place of the Warsaw Convention. The Warsaw Convention, as you saw in the contractual provisions in the IATA example, it took place in 1929, so it was kind of old. And a lot of the provisions within the Warsaw Convention were kind of like grandfathered in the Montreal Convention. And as far as the United States is concerned, a lot of disputes, as we shall see shortly, which found its way into the court litigation and court opinions, which interpret the Warsaw Convention, they were kind of like grandfathered into the Montreal Convention as well. So a lot of principles, a lot of interpretations, including the agency provisions, which are applicable to Warsaw Convention, they are found applicable to the Montreal Convention itself. So the bottom line is, whenever you think or see the Warsaw Convention, usually that means the Montreal Convention as well. All right, so that's for the Warsaw Montreal background. So now we're going to go to the convention itself. So we're not going to read the whole document. And I have the PDF provisions, which really outline the main stuff, the meat, if you will, of the things which I think are relevant. Before we even go there, what I think would be nice, let me see if I have it up. I think some of you remember that I have mentioned the case law, the state law, and the federal law. So, as we know, the Department of State, whatever the convention signed and posted on the Department of State website, is a federal law. And if it's a federal law, we have the section six. I'm sorry, Article 6, Clause 2 of the United States Constitution, which is also referred to as the Supremacy Clause, which reads as follows. This Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made pursuant to, thereof, and all treaties made, and of course, Montreal Convention is a treaty, shall be the supreme law of the land. So in other words, this is sometimes it's also referenced as preemption clause. This is something which preempts the state law. So let's say something took place in New York, and New York is a more favorable for the party who has title to the goods, not to the freight forwarder. If the freight forwarder is able to claim the Montreal Convention, because of this particular Article 6, Clause 2, they can say, well, federal law preempts, so I'm gonna, instead of going in the state court, I'm gonna run to the federal court, and in the federal court, I'm going to take advantage of the provisions within that Montreal Convention provides, not the more harsh provisions that the, for example, New York transportation law provides. All right, so or you can stay in the state court and argue the same thing, saying, listen, judge, this is the stuff which should be evaluated not under New York transportation law, but under the Montreal Convention. So pretty much what this particular section of the Constitution provides is it provides the preemption. And under that preemption doctrine, what we have is we have whatever the laws are made within the state of New York or the city of New York or wherever else, they are being displaced by the federal law, which in this case is Montreal Convention. Please pay attention. I know many folks take interest in the Constitution. This particular one is various government bodies provide the Constitution itself, but this one particular comes from the official side of U.S. Congress. It has annotations, and those annotations, they do provide the interpretation. So, for example, the clause 2, it talks about the early doctrine of the early days of the Republic. It talks about the dual federalism, and it talks about its current state. So, so those of you who like history and see how the legal history evolves, please take a look at that particular annotations, because it's very much it's very interesting to see how the same language, the same paragraph, with time changes. So, but this is beyond the scope of this particular stream. So, I'm going to move on and focus on the provisions of the Montreal Convention itself, because the saying goes, the devil is in the details. Speaking of the details, we do know that the convention itself applies to the international movement of persons, baggage and cargo. In this case, we're interested in cargo provision, and it must be the international carriage. And international carriage means between it is a term of art, most of the time international carriage really means like from Hong Kong to New York, let's say. Please take a look and note the paragraph 3 on the next page. It says carriage to be performed by several successive carriers for the purpose of convention to be one undivided carriage. So, in other words, there are a bunch of routings, charts, and other ways to get from point A to point B. And this is, as long as this is designed to be one carriage, then it falls within. And since it applies, as we shall see later, to carriers, So we're talking about like Delta Airlines, the Singapore Airlines, the Korean Air, or the guys who fly the actual planes. And their agents are also within that particular rubric as well. The next one, which I think is very much relevant within the body of the text, is the carriage of cargo. So remember that particular document that I was waving in front of you, the airway bill, right? It says airway bill shall be delivered. However, if it is not delivered, as we shall later see, it's okay. And why is it okay? Because we know that on the next page it says non-compliance with the provisions of articles 4 to 8 shall not affect the existence or validity of a contract for carriage. So normally speaking, if you go if you provide the airway bill, or if you have some kind of dispute related to the airway bill is the contract itself. So whatever else besides the airway bill, they are supporting documentation, and usually there is documentation packet. So there is a packing list, there is a commercial invoice. But way bill, if let's say if you go to the court and you make an argument, the airway bill will be the document which is regarded as a contract. So it is an important document. It is important to stick to the form, and the reason for it, we shall see, can be a deal breaker or a deal maker for the freight forwarding community. But if you don't go strictly with the terms, so let's say you have a cargo manifest, let's say, not an airway bill. So as you can see, for example, Adam. We have Article 4, other means. We have that other means rubric at the end of the paragraph 2. So, consignment to accident information containing the record preserved by such other means, for example. So that can go too. So, form is important, but it's not fatal, in other words. Moving on. Sticking to the form is important, but if you don't stick to the form, it doesn't have to be fatal. I think I already mentioned that if you do stick to the form under Article 11, airway bill is the prima facie. Prima facie means on its face. It's like right then and there. It's the evidence of the conclusion of the contract. So that's why you can make an argument because of Article 11, Paragraph 1, that the way bill is the contract. All right. So delivery of cargo. So or the loss of cargo. What happens if you lose the stuff? We have that possibility, and unfortunately that happens. There are certain provisions that kick in if the freight is lost, stolen, or otherwise went missing, or damaged. The damage also goes because it goes into the deterioration of the product. There is this 7-day rule. By the way, it's also, even though those rules are there, usually you have to look at the substance and kind of look at the merits, don't look at the form. Although sometimes you see courts looking at the form, and that can be a real challenge. So Article 16, they do for the first time mention we do have a situation where we have agents. Okay, so but this relates to customs police and other public authorities. So let's say you let's say you said one thing, but the air freight carrier said it's another thing, and because of that, the stuff got seized by customs. This is the situation, which is really not applicable because we primarily talking about the criminal stuff or about the negligent stuff or stuff that just simply went missing. So for this stuff, we have Article 18, which says the carrier is liable for damage sustained in the event of destruction or loss of damage. So by that definition, so it's kind of like a strict liability provision, right? So it places carrier liable, for but then it says the carrier is liable for the stuff that took place during the carriage by air, and I'm talking about the last sentence of the paragraph one. And the carriage by air, as we shall see, is really the term of art. Because take a look at the paragraphs 3 and 4. It says the period during which the cargo is in charge of the carrier, and it must be during, I'm looking at the paragraph 4, carriage by air. It does not extend to any carriage by land, by sea, inland, waterway performed outside of the airport. So one may think, wow, that's kind of clear. So pretty much if it's within, let's say, JFK Airport in New York, that's fine. But if it takes place right outside, that doesn't apply. So if I'm a freight forwarder and I have a contract for the, let's say, the CFS or the warehouse location, which is not within the airport grounds, it's close, but it's not on the airport grounds, then that's it. Montreal Convention doesn't apply. Well, not so fast, not so fast, because because the second sentence says, if, however, such carriage takes place in the performance of a contract for carriage by air for the purpose of loading, delivery, transshipment, any damage is presumed subject to the proof to contract to have been a result of event which took place during the carriage by air. In other words, what it says is, remember the earlier paragraphs that we read, we talked about the matrix, the stuff which the routing, port to port, transloading, transshipping, etc., etc. So this is the stuff that we're talking about. So in other words, the Montreal Convention, the applicability of Montreal Convention does not stop at the gates of the airport. You have to look further. All right, so limits of liability. So we do know that if Montreal Convention is applicable, then liability kicks in. What is that liability? Well, unless remember that contract provision where that I talked about earlier, where we discussed the no value declared NDV box. Unless you have that, the provision provides the Montreal Convention provides that it is going to be 17 drawing rights for per kilogram. So, and what is drawing rights per kilogram? Well, this is something which is determined by the United Nations, and it's fluctuating exchange rate, and it's a basket of currencies, and that basket of currencies is posted by the United Nations, and it's available right here. So latest, so we have today, October 20th, 2020, we do find that $1 equals 0.706281 SDR. So that would be the weight, that would be the provision, that the how you calculate. But then if you go back to that Montreal Convention, so 17 special drawing rights per kilogram. So the bill of lading has to have a kilogram. They have weight. So you look at the weight. You look at that formula that is posted by the on the United Nations official website, and you multiply it by 17 SDR per kilogram, multiply it by the SDR conversion, and there you find the dollar amount. So, normally speaking, that particular SDR provision is much, much less, especially for most of the commodities, it's much, much less than the commercial value of the cargo. This is the very reason why the article 22, paragraph 3 is the primary reason why many transportation companies would love to avail themselves of the provisions within the Montreal Convention, and this is the reason why the IATA provision, right, the contractual provisions of IATA on the airway bill, they do talk about the Montreal Convention and the limits of liability within the Montreal Convention, because they do want that 17 special drawing rights per kilogram option, because it's much more favorable as far as liability exposure is concerned for the air carriers. All right, so the next thing that I'm going to the most interesting portion of the convention, and we're talking about the Article 30. And Article 30 says if an action is brought against a servant or an agent of the carrier arising out of damage, such servant agent, provided that they acted within the scope of their employment, so in other words, they didn't act outside the scope of their employment, so they didn't steal, they didn't do the damage which is intentional, they just did their thing within their duties, shall be entitled to avail themselves of the conditions and limits of liability which the carrier itself is entitled to invoke under this convention. So in other words, whatever is airline operator, the carrier can avail itself, the agent or the freight forwarder can avail themselves also. Last but not least, so we covered this when we were reviewing the contract, but we also have the provision which is the statute of limitation. And the statute of limitation is, of course, 2 years. So this is one of the things you look at. Did the time pass or did it not pass? Another one that talks about agents specifically, servants or agents, is Article 43, which pretty much repeats the article that we just read, the Article 30, which says that the extent of liability for the agent is the same extent of liability for the carrier.